What's shaking, guys? My name is Luke Dancy, and I am very excited today to bring you the one and only, the master illusionist himself, Greg Gleason. How are you, sir?
I'm great. Thanks for having me, Luke.
Nah, man. Thank you for doing this. I know that normally, like a lot of the guys I've been talking to, normally you would be way too busy to do this. I know that you travel a lot performing, and you're on stages all over the world, and I'm glad that we have a chance to connect before you end up getting back to that lifestyle all over again.
I know. It's a nice little break.
Yeah, man. Yeah. So why don't we jump in and let the guys know who you are? I'm gonna run your reel while you're kind of chatting there and let the guys know all about you. So who is master illusionist Greg Gleason? There we go. So why don't you talk about yourself here? I know it sounds weird, but why don't you talk about yourself while we show this?
Okay. This is a promo reel. I probably did this 4 or 5 years ago. And that's when I was at the MGM in Venice, and I was at Bally's all of 2018, so that's not on there. But there's still a lot of my favorite illusions. Some of these scenes are from the cruise ship. Some of them are from China Tour. Some of them are from the Masters of Illusion TV show. As you can see, some of those backgrounds is their logo. And just some of my favorite illusions that I've been lucky enough to perform all over the world.
And this is what you do. You are an illusionist, and you have what I like to call the toys for the big boys. You've got all the fun stuff.
You know what? I do. And I think I have 54 illusions, 55, and they're all in a big warehouse.
Nice. The dream. That is the dream of so many of us when we're kids and we're seeing this stuff on TV. And you're like, man, just one day, I wish I could have that. And you do, which is really cool.
it was the same thing. I was just a kid watching it on TV saying, wow, you know, watching originally Mark Wilson and then Bill Bixby in the TV series, The Magician. And then, of course, Doug Henning burst onto the scene.
Oh, yeah. And we've got some really fun stuff to show you guys here. Speaking of Doug Henning, we'll bring this up in just a couple of minutes, but we've got something really, really cool to show you guys when it comes to Doug Henning, a piece of history, which is really, really cool.
Maybe a couple pieces. Maybe we'll do a couple pieces of history.
Yes. So if you guys like illusions, if you love this kind of stuff, if you want to know more about it, number one, ask questions. That's why we're here live. Number two, get ready. You're going to see some really cool stuff. And number three, if you have any magic buddies that love this kind of stuff, go ahead and hit the share button. Let them know. Spread the word. Pop this up in some magic groups. And also, you guys have a chance to win some free stuff today just by liking and commenting on the video. I do announce the winners after this in a couple hours or so. So go ahead and get in there, hooking you guys up with some good stuff. But up first,
what are they going to win? Hey, Luke, what are they going to win?
We actually just released a deck of cards today called the Gold Goblins.
Okay.
And so we're going to throw some decks of cards around today. So, yeah, that'd be fun.
I can throw some... the Gleason Magic posters from the Venetian show or the rap cards or stuff like that, too. If you want, I can bring some of those over for you.
That would be awesome, dude. All right. So we're going to hook you guys up with all kinds of fun stuff today. So, and thank you for that. That's very cool.
Yeah.
We have got a question coming in already over on the old Facebook. Mark Wybrow, good to see you, Mark. He says, what is your favorite illusion you love to perform? Damn it, that was going to be one of my questions, but okay.
Wow. You know... It's hard to pick one because they're all so much fun to do. I do a thing, it looks like a pole levitation where I'm floating up and we take both poles away and then I end up floating all the way up to the light grid and then back down. They pass the hoops over me, which is a lot of fun. The water levitation is one of my favorites to do.
Are you talking about this one, Greg?
That's it. Okay. This was on a cruise ship, believe it or not. And,
wow.
And you know what, Luke? This was my opening illusion of the show. They introduced me and the curtains opened and I walked back and I sat down on that table. The music started. It was, what was that? It was a Van Halen track that, you know, was real high energy, rock and roll. And I float up and the girl takes away one and then she takes away the other one. And oh, there I go.
Dude, you know, a lot of times when you see the pole levitation, as you know, you go up, they take the poles away, and you're left with the one, and then you come back and you go back down. This, what a nice, man, that's beautiful, all the way up, too. On a cruise ship. You're on a freaking cruise ship. That's nuts.
And then, yep, I would do that, and then I'd float right back up. They passed the hoops over me, and you know, just the audience just sat down, and they're just coming to a magic show, and all of a sudden you're hitting them with this right off the top.
Wow.
And then I land, and the curtains close right when I land. I think you'll see that in a second. And there I come down, the curtains close right at the right time. And then I'm gonna be walking through.
Ladies and gentlemen, Greg Gleason.
I walk out and I say, now that's how you open a show. And, you know, that was a pretty serious illusion right at the beginning. And then I say, you know, we were backstage right before the show, and one of those assistants bet me I couldn't hula hoop with one of those 6-foot steel hoops. And I go, I bet I can. Would you like to see? They bring out one of those giant hoops. You know, they're 6 feet. And, it was, you know, it was serious, and then all of a sudden it was really fun. There I am hula hooping with a giant 6-foot hula hoop. So it showed, you know, good magic, and then it just showed that I didn't take anything really serious either.
Got some people saying how amazing that looked. Chris Dunn here on the old Facebook says, what a great opening. That is a pretty, you know, badass way to open your show. I mean, damn. That is,
we'll show a couple more clips from that show later on. I think you have a couple more.
Yeah, I got a bunch of Greg Gleason goodness to show today. So I am excited to show the guys more illusions from the repertoire of master illusionist Greg Gleason.
I don't even put the ending of that show on Facebook or on YouTube or anything. The final illusion is I don't want anyone to ever see it unless they see it live, because it's such a huge surprise.
It will stay a surprise, I guess, for now.
Yeah.
Over on YouTube, because we are streaming in a few different places here, Rest Magic says, how do I start getting on the stage, and what are some things I should know beforehand? So why don't we make it a little more vague there? How do you start getting into stage magic, I guess, is a good question. Yeah.
I think I didn't start with stage magic. I started with, you know, the more parlor kind of magic, the ropes and rings. And this is back in the 70s when I started, and with a newspaper tear, and it was mostly parlor, but I also focused a lot on close-up magic. And in 76, they put out, Mark Wilson put out his Mark Wilson course. And that was really a game changer for me, because inside the Mark Wilson course, it taught some great card slides, but it also taught a complete cups and balls routine with ending with the big loads. It did a complete billiard ball routine. And then it had a couple of illusions at the back that I made out of cardboard and ended up producing my little sister out of a Arabian tent. That was the first thing I had ever built. And
cool.
And then ended up building my own illusions, because when you're, 15 or 16, you can't afford $1,000 illusions. So the Paul Osborne plans were out at that time, and ended up building a sub-trunk and a zigzag. And oh no, did I lose you?
No, I'm still here, my friend. I'm still here. I'm just listening and absorbing all this.
For some reason, I lost the whole screen and everything.
No, I still see you. Trust me, we can see you right now, looking at your computer. You're still there, and I'm here.
Yep. Okay, good.
I kind of did the same thing, actually, when you're talking about the back of the book with the illusions and stuff. I believe for me, it was the later volumes of Tarbell. You know, Tarbell had some of the bigger stuff, quote unquote, bigger stuff that you could make yourself. And that was pretty cool too. So it's kind of interesting to hear how you got interested in that too. So
there's some great stuff in Tarbell. There's the first shadow box I ever did was in Tarbell. And it wasn't a great method, but it got me out there doing it. There's a sack escape. I don't know what they call it in there, but Doug Henning did it on one of his specials. It's a great, great small illusion. And if I was starting out in illusions, that's one of the first ones I would probably put in the show. It's you get someone from the audience to come on stage, and you borrow their jacket or something like that. Doug borrowed their jacket, and then you'd get in the bag, and they would tie the sack around the top, and the guy from the audience would hold the top of the bag, and Doug would be out, and the guy's jacket would still be in. It's a great illusion, and it, as far as getting, back to the question about getting on stage, though, that we started with, I think you just have to be able to, you know, try to be very versatile, and every situation is going to be different. I started doing birthday parties, which isn't getting on stage, but that gave me the practice to get on like talent shows in high school, and then later on putting together a little bigger show. And I was lucky. I was living in Texas, and Magic Island wasn't too far away. So Magic Island in Houston gave me my start.
I was very fortunate to go there once, and I hope that one day maybe it'll actually come back to life, but I'm not keeping my fingers crossed at this point.
I know. Don't hold your breath. Keep your fingers crossed, but don't hold your breath.
Speaking of holding your breath, what is that behind you there, Greg, over your left shoulder? Actually, both of those, I guess, would be for holding your breath.
Actually, I'm sitting in the Houdini kitchen. This is my kitchen. And the tall cabinet is a water torture cell. Bill Smith built that for me. And I don't think I'll ever be doing it, but I just wanted to have one. And the lower one right here is Owen's milk can.
Nice.
And so you have to hold your breath on both of those. And above is a straight jacket. And I was very fortunate on one of the cruises. I work a lot of high-end cruises. And a guy came up to me after one of the shows, this about 20 years ago, and said, "Did you ever see the movie Houdini?" And I said, "Yeah, that's one of the reasons." That was one of the first things I saw, even before the Doug Henning specials came along. It got me really interested in magic. And I had that straight jacket made. It looks exactly like the one that Tony Curtis wore in the movie Houdini.
Very cool. And as we mentioned earlier about some history, we're talking about Houdini here. We're talking about, you know, water torture cells. You've also been getting your hands on some Doug Henning stuff. And I've got some pictures that we were talking about earlier. So if you guys would like to see some history, get ready, because this is okay. Going to be really cool.
Should we set this up?
I'll let you jump on in, man, and I'll run the pictures for you. I got you.
Okay. This is one of my good friends, Kirby Van Birch. In 1989, Doug Henning had a sale. He put an ad in Genie magazine selling some of his top illusions, and because he was retiring. And one of them was a statue of Pharaohs that he bought. He also bought the water levitation and walking through the mirror. And I got the statue of Pharaohs from him for probably 5 or 6 years ago. Maybe we can show you that in a few minutes. But just recently, I went down to Houston and got the walking through the mirror from him. And when he bought it in 1989, his character was completely different than Doug Henning's, you know, flower child, hippie character. He was a rock and roller, so he didn't want the clouds and stuff painted on the side. So he had taken it to Bill Smith's shop, and they laminated it with a gold laminate and put some black trim and stuff on it. Completely different look, same illusion, but completely different look. And when I got it from him a couple weeks ago, I told him I'm going to refurbish it back to what it looked like when it was originally built and used on one of his specials. And I sent, there it is right there. So that's what it looked like. That's the side and back of it. And that's when I got it from Kirby about a week ago. And then I brought it back to Houston, and taking the laminate off was a blast, because it was like a, you know, finding a treasure, because I had never seen this paint job. And I talked to Willie Kennedy, who originally built this prop, after I took off that laminate. We were talking about this paint job, and he goes, "Oh yeah, you know, on the road things get beat up pretty bad." And Doug had gone to a different backdrop that was more clouds, and he wanted the props to look more like that. So that was the paint job, but I had never seen that. And but the original paint job, if you can see that, it's kind of a gradient from the top. It starts off blue and then goes green, yellow, orange, red, and it's got some blue looking clouds. It looked more like spaceships, but I think they were clouds. Anyway, that's what it's going to look like in about 2 weeks from now. And there's Doug coming through it, actually. There's a mirror slides in the front, and then he puts a piece of paper over the mirror, and then he ends up walking right through the mirror. It's a Jim Steinmeier illusion.
Very cool. So there you go, guys. A true look at history. This is what it this is what it looked like when he got it. You know, this is a Doug Henning original illusion that's now in the possession of Mr. Greg Gleason. Very cool. And it's awesome that not only are you, you know, getting your hands on this stuff, but also that you're going to take the time to also refurbish them and make them new again and literally bring new life into classic pieces like that. That's really, really cool, especially for the history.
I look forward to performing it soon, and it'll be on one of the TV shows pretty soon.
Speaking of TV shows, I am all about segues. Talking of TV shows, I'm going to show a couple clips of you here. Okay. This is one of your favorite illusions. You and I were talking before this. This is the levitation of the girl, which I got to be honest, the first time I saw someone make a, well, I'm not going to ruin the surprise at the moment, but I'll let you talk about this because this is really beautiful.
Okay. Let's get into it before. But yeah, this was the Masters of Illusion taping maybe 2 or 3 years ago. And there we go. You know what? This is a Brett Daniels illusion, and Brett sold me the rights to it.
Nice.
And the first time I saw it, I go, that's just brilliant. You know, all of a sudden a girl just appears floating in midair. And then she does the levitation part. And you know, this is Brett's brainchild, and it's just a beautiful illusion. And I love performing it. I changed it a little bit of technique away from Brett does it to how I do it. And
that's actually the name I was going to mention before. That's the first place I ever saw this was on Masters of Illusion on the World's Greatest Magic.
Yep.
Brett did this, and when he made the girl appear in air like that, I'm like, whoa.
But I know it. Yeah, it was like the first time watching that Gary Willett show, World's Greatest Magic, when Greg Fruin made the birdcage vanish and the girl appeared.
Oh yeah,
that was another one of those moments, like wow. And but yeah, you know, this is a triple illusion. There's three different things going on here during this illusion. So it's not just a levitation; it's an appearance, and then the levitation, and then the Azra coming up here.
And for me, this is what's fun is, as a kid, watching the World's Greatest Magic and seeing guys do this stuff on TV. And now with Masters of Illusion, that's kind of what's taken over the World's Greatest Magic, kind of the series on TV. And that's so beautiful, dude. Being able to talk to you as someone that does this is, it's a treat for me, to be honest with you, because, you know, you see these guys on TV as a kid and you look up to this, you look at this stuff and you look up to the guys doing it. And to live in a city now, I live in Las Vegas, as you do as well, to be able to hang out with people like you and get to know you, it's just a really, really cool thing, you know, because you guys are doing the stuff that it's just, yeah, I wish I could be doing that type of stuff. Yeah.
You know, you never know until one day. I used to own nightclubs when I was 20. When I graduated from college, I was managing nightclubs immediately right out of school. And did that for 3 years, 23, 24, 25. And when I was 26, I thought I knew everything. I go, I'm going to open my own nightclub. And it was in Dallas, Texas. And luckily, you know what? It ended up exploding, and not exploding, but business-wise exploding. And we, you know, all of a sudden we're doing 1,200 people every Friday and 1,200 people every Saturday. And it was so much fun. And I could, you know, I could run the club, but I could still do magic. I wasn't doing stage stuff, but I was doing, you know, stuff at the bar, and it was my club, so I could do whatever I wanted. But it turned into a live music venue, and a lot of famous bands actually came out of there. So it was fun to give a lot of bands their break.
Very cool. I've got a few more illusions queued up here. I love watching this stuff. Let's now jump in. This is another one I really, really like. I think you and I were talking about this one earlier, too. That you had someone that you know that's making one right now. This guy right here, dude.
Oh,
this.
You know what? I'll tell you about this. Again, it's on Masters of Illusion. We shot this probably 2015. So I'd already been doing it 13 years. Dan Summers is a good friend of mine, lives in Houston. Met him when I was working at Magic Island in Houston. And when I was getting ready to open my show at the Venetian, in Las Vegas in 2002, I was talking to Dan. I was already doing his Compressed in the show for a few years, but when we were open at the Venetian, I wanted to put some new things in the show. And he goes, I have this idea of cutting a girl into eight pieces. And we looked at it. I looked at it and I go, you know, that would be a really, that's a really great idea. But I think if we actually put a photo of the girl on the front of the box and the back of the box, it would really sell it a lot more. And this thing is extremely, extremely deceptive. Every time we go to a new venue, when we're doing one-nighters, we always pull out of a case and it's pretty complex. There's, you know, everything has to slide together perfect when you got, you know, four boxes on one side and four on the other. And when we're doing that backstage and the regular techs that helped unload the truck, they can be completely surrounding us while we do that and 3 feet away, and they have no idea where that girl is.
Wow.
It is an extremely, extremely deceptive prop. Me and Dan Summers built that and put it into the show. We just got it done maybe a week before the show, and then had a week to rehearse.
Wow.
Rehearse this illusion plus all the other illusions that were going in the show. And then Bill Smith saw the show and he goes, I love that illusion, I'll build it for you, Dan. So Bill has been building them since 2002, and just recently Ray Lum built one, a custom one that turned out really, really nice too. But it's a fun illusion. We just did it at the castle last time I was there last summer, and to see that, you know, the palace is not a very big stage, and to see that completely fills the stage.
Beautiful, beautiful. That's one of my favorites too, honestly.
It's one of mine. See, that's why when they say what's your favorite, I go, they're all my favorite. I went to. I love every one of them.
This was a random question. If you don't want to answer specifically, that's okay. Mark Wybrow's back again. He says, I know illusions are not cheap. What is the most expensive illusion that you own? Maybe it's just a collector's piece, but is there like one piece that stands out from all the others?
Most expensive illusion I own would probably be the helicopter appearance.
Yeah.
Mike Michaels builds the, if it's an expensive illusion, but it wasn't as that expensive for me because I designed it and built it. Mike Michaels built the helicopter, and it was right when Mike came up with that idea and said, hey, look at this. And he was working on this helicopter idea. And I said, well, it's a great idea, but I don't like black art. I'm not going to do a helicopter with black art. Okay, and then this clip is kind of upsetting to me because I remember shooting this. This was the live, we shoot this during the day, and then we shoot it again at night. And look how dark that is, but it doesn't have to be dark. It can be fully lit. There is no black art involved in this. And I remember we shot it. We had a great light for the rehearsal during the day. We shot it during the day. And then at night, I was standing, it was like, okay, we're going to do the helicopter. So I brought out the box and we're getting ready to do it. This isn't even shot yet. I have cruise ship footage better than this. But you can at least see through it, you know.
Yep.
But I literally stood there for like 30 to 45 seconds before we even did the trip, just waiting for them to go to the right light cue. And they never did. And I finally said, is this what light cue we're using? I was like, this isn't what we spend half an hour or an hour this, you know, this afternoon setting up.
Bam.
And but as far as expensive illusions go, to buy the rights from me to do this and have Bill Smith build the box and Mike build the helicopter and then the cases for it, this one ends up costing about $70,000.
Wow. And if I'm not mistaken, you used to do this on cruise ships of all places, right?
I did it on cruise ships the very beginning. And what was nice was Mike finished the helicopter and we shipped it to the cruise ship. At the same time, me and my welders were building the box, and we never had time to check to see if it was even going to work. And we got it to the cruise ship, and it didn't work. And luckily, there's welders on the ship, there's carpenters on the ship.
Oh yeah.
And they came in, and I said, "Look, this is what's supposed to happen," and we got it fixed, and all the cloth sides and everything. Everything's, it's a metal frame and everything's cloth, because I wanted this to not, I didn't want wood floors, because when you're traveling, all that weight just adds up.
Sure.
And there's upholstery facilities on the cruise ship. So I just bought material in Miami, and their fabric, and they have a fabric district. And I just bought in a bunch of material, and I paid the upholstery people to make all those cloths for me. So, believe it or not, a lot of it was actually done on the ship, and then we ended up doing. I did it on the ship for 2 years.
Wow, a freaking helicopter illusion on a cruise ship. That's
that's
badass, dude. That's cool.
People always say, "Where's the helicopter?" And they go, "It's out on the helipad."
Here's a great question, actually. Okay. A little tongue-in-cheek question here, but John Czar would like to know, where do all the beautiful girls come from? That is one perk of being an illusionist, is having girls surround you on the daily.
and you know what? It's a different answer all the time. If I'm working on the cruise ships, they have a production cast usually, and I will hire the dancers from the production cast. If it's the TV show, I will, living in Las Vegas, there's a lot of dancers and showgirls, so I will put an ad on Facebook and go from there. Right. And then when I find good ones, I keep them as long as I can.
So the real answer is you can't just make them appear whenever you like.
I wish, I know.
Okay.
You know what? You never marry them or date them. That way you can make them disappear anytime.
You're dropping the knowledge. You were dropping the goods.
There you go.
This was a question that came up earlier that's interesting.
That lesson cost me a lot of money.
Gotcha. there was a question about, this is it. Also from Mark. Mark's full of questions today.
Okay.
When you do an illusion, did it ever go wrong, and how did you get out of it? So obviously things are going to go wrong. Tell us about that.
You know what? The one that we just showed a little while ago, the cutting in eights when the box splits.
Yep.
Well, one time it only split here. And here we go. Instead of coming all the way apart, it only split to here.
Oh,
and now it won't come apart, and it won't go back together. So when it comes to here, the audience didn't know there was a problem. So I came to here and I said, "Okay, spin it." So they spun it, and then I tried to push it together or pull it apart, and it was stuck. And I said, "Okay, spin it again."
Oh gosh.
And then we tried it again, and then I said, "Okay, close curtains." And then I said, "You know, there's a better show going on backstage than there is out here right now." Because they had to figure out how to get her out of there, and I just went on to the next trick. So,
sure.
You know, things are going to go wrong, and you just, you know, I just laugh about it. It's you know, if you make it a serious thing, then the audience, you know, then they have a different perception. But if you just laugh at it, they're just going to laugh at it too. They know something's wrong.
Yep.
You know, just laugh. Same thing with a floating girl. A girl got stuck in the air, and she wasn't going to come back down. And do you have the girl on the feather boa?
I do not have that one queued up now.
Oh, okay.
No, sorry. Yeah.
So she's floating on a feather boa, and I sit down on a chair underneath her and snap my fingers, and she wakes up, and then later on I bring her back down to the chair, but she was just locked up there. She wasn't coming down. And I go, "Oh, okay." And I just sat down on the chair and crossed my legs and said, "Close curtains." And then the curtains closed, and I said, and then when the curtains are closed, I walked forward and I said, "I'll be right back." I knew the stagehands had no idea how to get her down. So
that's funny.
So you know what? But that, you, if you plan ahead and you realize what can go wrong, you're going to be in much better shape. I did a show at the MGM, and I did it 9,400 times. It was an illusion show. And if anything could go wrong, it was going to go wrong, because we did it 9,400 times.
Yep.
And one time we were doing the guillotine, and literally we were doing 12 shows a day, and it was amazing. This is 93 through 96. Every show sold out. So the theater only held 100 people. It was theater in the round. And every show sold out, and we had 3 minutes in between shows to reset the show and for the next group to come in. And what was crazy was, I don't know what happened, but we do a giant guillotine. For some reason, the guillotine wasn't set. When the blade comes down, it would end up in the stocks, and the stocks would go off stage. But during this next show, the blade was never set back into the guillotine. And I'm doing the show. This is probably like maybe a year into it or something. And I go over to pull up the stocks, and my assistant comes out with the blade, with the stocks that the blade's in, and he's like pointing at the stock, pointing at the blade inside the stocks. And I go, whoa! I go, oh, my assistant Jeff just brought out a brand new blade. Just had it sharpened, and it's in the stocks. Hey, Jeff, bring me that blade. And I set the blade right in front of the audience, and they had no idea. But I just made it part of the show.
You know, that's the sign of a pro, though, is that you don't get, you know, you're going to have things happen. They're going to,
yeah.
Upstairs, you're mentally going, oh, my God, oh, my God, oh, my God. But when you're able to just keep it going, the audience doesn't know what's supposed to happen anyway.
They don't.
You know? So that's the sign of a pro. And that only happens by performing, obviously.
And, you know, you can learn a lot of that doing sleight of hand, too, because if something happens, you know, if you're doing something with cards and you miss a card or something, you know, there's a lot of outs you can do. You can, you know, chop change it later on. Or you can. There's so many things you can do. And by using those lessons from sleight of hand to illusions, it'll help you out a lot by understanding you can do that.
Speaking of sleight of hand and, you know, doing close-up magic, Chris Dunn's got a good question to kind of go along with that.
Okay.
What's your favorite go-to effect when asked to perform something off stage? So obviously you're not just going to have illusions with you everywhere you go. So do you have any favorites to do when you're off stage and someone catches you and says, hey, magic boy, magic, come on.
You know what? I never do any. I only do magic in my shows.
Okay.
And, you know, if they want to sit down and watch magic for 10 or 15 minutes, maybe I'll sit down. But if someone says do a trick, I never have.
I get it. Totally.
I know there's a lot of people that are always set up and want to. And I just, you know, if they come to one of my shows or my next show's at so-and-so, I've never done that.
And
I could. I mean, I could sit down and do an hour easy, but I pick and choose when I want to do it.
Well said. And the cool thing about what Greg does too is we're talking all this about the illusions, the big stuff that he does. But the really cool thing is you've also now started doing cruise ships where you just do close-up shows, but you do it to a theater of like 1,000 people.
1,200 people.
Yeah. It's crazy.
Yeah. You know what? That's all I've done on ships for the last 8 years. And for the last 8 years, I have a carry-on bag, and the carry-on bag has it has an hour close-up show that I do in the 1,200-seat theaters because it was designed for a camera and projection video screens. I have an hour mentalism show, and I have my costumes all in a carry-on bag. So if my luggage gets lost, I'm still set up to do 2 hours of material.
And you also do a memory act as well.
Yep.
You know, that's something else that you do. That's, while it's not magic, it's another side of you that you're able to go on a cruise ship and do this memory demonstration and teaching. And
you know what? Sometimes there's 1,000 people in that audience for the memory seminars.
Crazy.
I talk about it in my shows, and it's usually the next afternoon, and it's a perfect opportunity for the cruise line to offer something in the afternoon that's not shuffleboard or, you know, something that actually people can benefit from. And it all started when I was reading Harry Lorraine book called Reputation Makers when I was in college, and it taught the basics of basically just of the rhyming peg system. And I said, wow, this is, it actually went up to 16, but it was mainly the rhyming peg system. And then I went out and bought all Harry's memory books and ended up learning, using that through college, and got straight A's in college. And it was funny, I was on a high-end cruise ship, and the cruise director, it was in the program, the next day the cruise director was going to do a memory seminar. And I went, oh, this is great, I love memory seminars. And I went, and he could do it pretty well, but I could do it a lot better. And so I said, can I do that next cruise? And he goes, do you know how to do it? Oh, sure, I know how to do that. I go, I'll memorize a Time Magazine and do a Time Magazine demonstration at the beginning, and then I'll just run the peg system, and I don't remember names. And that was in 99, and I've done it, I think I've memorized the Time Magazine almost every week up until this coronavirus. So for 20 years, I memorized Time Magazines every week.
Wow. Wow, that's pretty rad, dude. Not everybody can say that, that's for sure. Wow. Also, guys, I've got one more clip to show of Greg, and then he's going to show us a couple of other pieces around his place there, so stay tuned for that. Also, if you haven't yet, I've got it going down below there. If you want to make sure you don't miss this when we go live every week, all you need to do is in the comments just say the word live, and we will make sure that you get hooked up with the notifications that you need to know when we do go live. One last clip I've got here. This one is a fun one where you are the one normally, you know, putting the girls in the boxes and putting swords or blades to the girls. This one, Greg Gleason, is one where you get cut up a little bit here. Why don't we talk about this guy?
Yeah.
So what are we looking at here? That's beautiful.
Actually, back to the expensive questions, that was at that time when I bought that, by far the most expensive prop I had paid for. That was at Owens had made that, and you know, nothing at Owens is inexpensive. The thing is actually a piece of art. The aluminum, the construction of this thing is amazing. It's all automated. Kerry Pollack did the actuators on the top to get those doors to open like that. And it was, I remember seeing it at a magic convention at the SAM in Las Vegas, and seeing that and all that opening by itself, and it's like, wow. And it was 20 grand. And then I went to Owen's shop like 3 or 4 years later, and it was made for someone 6'4". And you know, these disembodies have to be made to your height, and he had it, you know, 4 years later, and I go, let's make a deal on that. So I didn't have to pay $20,000 for it, but it was still a lot of money.
And, it's a beautiful piece.
Up to that point, it was by far the most expensive. And, you know, we were talking a little bit about it. I saw Mark Wilson do that on It's Magic back in the 70s. It came on like 10:30 at night on a Saturday night or something. I knew how the zigzag worked, but I didn't. When I saw this and those doors opened and then that back door opened, I had no idea. I knew it was a fake kid, but I had no idea where the person went. I thought it was a great trick.
And that's what's really, really cool about that piece too, is when you see it live, I've seen this live, it'll warp your brain. It really does warp your brain.
Yeah.
Like you just can't wrap your head around what's going on. It's a cool one. I would think too, is that one of the illusions? Let's have a little mini real talk. Is that one of the illusions that when you perform it, you feel like you're a damn magician? Like, because this is you doing the piece, you know, it's not like you're doing something to someone else. Like you are the one kind of in control of this one, you know, like you go in, you do the thing, you come out.
You know what, as far as feel like really doing magic, when I do my water levitation illusion,
okay,
it really feels like magic, because when that was built, Kerry Pollack, who is just an electronics wizard, just a genius in electronics, he came over and saw, that's what's so great about living in Las Vegas and having all these, even though Kerry doesn't live in Las Vegas, he comes here, but like Kevin James is a good friend of mine, and that feather boa suspension, when the girl's putting on the feather boa, I was passing a hoop over, and Kevin listened to a song and looked at the whole effect and goes, you know, that would be a lot cooler if that was a heart instead of a hoop. And I go, you know what, you're right. And then he goes, and then it should light up. Oh man, and there's another $1,000. And sure enough, within a month, I had a neon heart that would light up that I'd pass over. But back to the water levitation, Kerry Pollack came over and he goes, you know, we could have, you know, this is 1996. We could program that so no one has to control it. You just push a button and the water will go. It's all time code. Water will go and the fuel will flow. Everything will go exactly the same every single time.
It's a beautiful and thing when those things.
So when I'm doing the water.
Oh, go ahead.
Yeah, it's just, you're right. It's just amazing because it's all time coded. You know everything's going to happen at exactly the same time. The water's going to come on, and then you're going to go like this. It's going to stop, and the girl's going to come up. And that's, to me, that feels like magic.
Gotcha. That's fair. Yeah, I mean, I think it was Copperfoot I saw back in the day do it on one of his specials. And just, yeah, and then I got to see you do it at Bally's. You did it at the Bally's show. You were in the Masters of Illusion show. Yeah, I forgot you did it there. Yeah. Very cool. And then I also had a couple of pictures I was going to show. Of course, we talked about and we showed the helicopter illusion, which I think, when, you know, if people think of Greg Leeson, they normally think of helicopters. You know, that's just what they do. And of course, levitating. I think this was one that you did. Was this the street magic show where you were outside doing this on the streets, or am I wrong?
That's on Hollywood Boulevard, and it originally aired on the Pop Network. It was called Don't Blink, and then they repackaged it on CW, and it's called Street Magic.
Gotcha.
And believe it or not, you know what? That is a sword suspension, but the sword is chrome, and you cannot see it.
Wait. So you're telling me in this picture, well, I guess it's also a little, I kind of chopped off the bottom of it, but wow.
That's a sword suspension.
Makes a great promo piece. You can't tell there's a sword there.
And even Jeff McBride saw that picture and he goes, that's like every magician's dream picture, to have a girl floating in the middle of the street with people all around like that.
Oh yeah.
The actions. And,
oh yeah.
And, no, it's just a great shot. I saw Hans Block post a picture recently of doing a sword suspension, and I wanted to crop it and send it to him and say, look, if you crop this, it looks like it's just floating. You can't see the sword.
here's a couple good questions, and then we'll start to wrap things up here.
Okay.
This is a great question. I know this one's close to you and a lot of your friends in the industry. When the ships begin to sail again, will there be magicians? Why don't we kind of talk about that real quick? Because things obviously are currently strange. They're different. How do you see the landscape of magicians going forward, whether it's cruise ships or just shows in general? Because, you know, no one really knows what's going on.
The novelty acts will be the first ones back. Because the production shows are normally, they're like their main staple, but now they're dealing with 18 people, and I just think their budget's gonna have a hard time with their budget, because the ships will not be sailing full. It's gonna take a while for the ships to start filling up. Originally, when the ships start sailing, they're gonna be like every other deck is gonna be used. I think the magicians and maybe jugglers and maybe vents. I think the variety acts, and I don't know about singers, because unless they're using tracks, you know, I don't know what it's going to deal on the band is going to be. I think the variety acts are going to have it's cheaper to hire the variety acts, and there's less rooms that they have to put them up in. I think the variety acts are going to be the first ones back.
Okay. A couple other quick questions here. This was a good one. From Mark, he's like, you know, illusions are expensive to buy, obviously.
Right.
So when it comes to selecting those tricks to purchase, You know, what kind of advice do you give someone when they're going to spend a chunk of money on something and they want to make sure it's the right thing for them? How about illusion selection? How do you kind of go about doing that, especially if you're new to this stuff and you want to start to do it?
I would say the first thing is get practical illusions that you can do anywhere. The sub trunk is a practical illusion. Room suspension is a practical illusion. There's a book by David Seebach that says, "So you want to be an illusionist." If I was thinking about buying illusions, that's the first book I would. If I was thinking about getting into illusions, that's the first book I'd buy. And he'll really say the same thing. Make sure it's practical. Where are you going to store it? You have room to store it. How are you going to transport it? How many people does it take to do it? If you're not in Vegas, how easy is it going to be to find assistance to use? All those questions.
Let me see. How have you spent your time during lockdown? That comes from Phil on Facebook. How have you spent your time during this quarantine thing we've been going through?
I've been spending a lot of time working on new sleight of hand routines. I have my main close-up show on the ship. It's called Catch Me If You Can, and it's an hour with a deck of cards. During quarantine, I was put finishing touches on the second hour of close-up magic. Again, it's almost all cards, and it's called 52 Ways to Cheat at Poker. It's a spoof of the song 50 Ways to Lose Your Lover. I've rewritten the first trick of 52 Ways to Cheat at Poker, and that's actually a running theme all the way through the show. So I'm actually more excited about doing this show than the one I've been doing for the last 8 years on Chips.
Oh wow. You have another funny thing that you do. Well, not funny, but another, to me it's funny, for a personal reason, but your routine, The Devil Went Down to Vegas, I think that's fantastic. I love that.
You know what? It's the opener of my close-up show, and actually, it's the second trick in. The first one's Virginia City Shuffle. It's just Greek Armani kind of thing. But as soon as I get out the cards and the devil went down to Vegas, and when did I put that together? 1986 is when I first put that together. Handling's changed a little bit, but the script I wrote for it, it's always been the same, and it's a lot of fun. And during the quarantine, I redid Hotel California, the Hotel Equivo, and it's going to be a really fun routine, and basically telling people how it works exactly. Hotel Equivo. But they don't know. They have no idea what Equivo means.
That's funny, dude. That's really
So I rewrote the whole song to Hotel California,
cool.
Hotel Equivo, and it's by far one of my new favorite pieces.
One last resource question, and then we'll take a peek at some of that stuff you were letting us know that you had in there. Nigel wants to know if you have any favorite books, not only on stage illusions, but on stage craft, maybe some resources that you could share. I think you mentioned a couple of things earlier, but
The Paul Osborne books are terrific. The first four or five books he put out all had tips, building tips all the way through it. It had, laminating and cutting the wood properly and right kind of casters. And it covers a lot of, just techniques on building illusions that most people won't. And even, I started in junior high with wood shop. It's a shame. I don't think they even offer that anymore in junior high and high school. But all through junior high and high school, I had wood shop and metal classes. So I learned how to do all that. But the Paul Osborne books, I think, is really the only source that is going to give you the tips.
And then based on that too. How do you feel about building your own illusions? James, excuse me, was asking that. Because you were just mentioning, that you started with the wood shop classes and stuff and kind of got the chops. Get it? Chops. Yeah, how do you feel about that? Like, are there things people should know? And how do you feel about people building their own illusions?
I'd say know how to use saws and use power tools before you even think about building something. You don't. I know too many people that have seriously hurt their hands, cut their fingers, maybe not off, but serious damage to their hands, unless really, unless you know what you're doing around power tools, I wouldn't recommend it at all.
No, well said. Well said. Leave it to the pros. Leave it to the pros.
Exactly.
Yep.
And you know what? There's so many right now. There are so many different places. When I started, there was no Magic Auction. There was no eBay. There was no usedmagicillusions.com. There was none of that. It was, you know, either you paid full price retail just about, or you didn't get one. And now some of these deals on Magic Auction and eBay, you can get great deals. I look at Magic Auction and use Magic Illusions. I'd say I've sold them on those, and I've gotten quite a few illusions at a fraction of the price on those sites. You know, it's interesting, look at this milk can. This milk can owns milk can, and it's probably $8,000 or $9,000. And Jay Leslie put this on his Facebook. He goes, "No one will even give me $1,000 for a milk can, because you know it's not a popular trick. How often are you going to use it, really?" But I have the Houdini kitchen, and I go, "I'll give you $1,000 for it." And
yep.
So, but you know, I'm in a good position. I worked on ships for 23 years, and I was at the MGM, Venetian, and Bally's. So I've had a really good career, and have some money. But even when I started in Magic, I didn't have $1,000 to buy a prop that's going to sit in my kitchen.
Yep. So. And I do remember the first time I bought my very first illusion. It was that's what I was sitting here thinking about. It's called Murder Incorporated. You remember that one with the box and the swords?
Yes, sure.
That was like, for me, that was a big deal. I was thinking in my head, like, wait, what's the name of that thing? Because I saved up so much money as a kid. It was only like a couple $100.
Yeah.
And I was so proud of that thing. And I think, I still have it back home in North Carolina. But, I mean, whether it's $1,000 or a couple $100, like, just for us, it's just cool to have those things, not only to use, but to have on display and stuff too. And you've got a lot of cool stuff to display and on display at your house that I know you mentioned before. We might get a little peek at some of these extra things that you've been collecting. Yeah. And
we can do that. I bought, back to the first illusion I bought was the Super X, and it was $75, and that was a lot of money to me.
Right.
It was a lot of money, and I really had to think about it. And then, but it ended up going into a show that I was doing. And it ended up being worth, it ended up being worth it. And it got me doing illusions on stage. And it was a thing in college.
Very cool.
So that was super rad.
All right. So I think I'm ready to see some stuff over there, my friend. If you don't mind, let's take a peek around.
I apologize for any kind of weird kind of movement here, but we'll go. This is my mantle here. And as you can see, those are all blooming rose bushes.
Nice.
And the center one is the most interesting. The one with the white blooms, custom made for me, and it's absolutely beautiful. And I used it on China tours, and I used it at the Venetian.
Nice.
But this one right in the center, this is actually feather flowers, and that was Harry Blackstone Senior's rose bush.
Wow, dude, that's cool. Wow.
And it works. All of these others are electronic, and this one was built in the 30s before the electronics, so it works with sand, and it's like an hourglass, you release the sand, and the sand comes down and ends up pushing the roses out. It's very, very clever.
That's cool.
You don't see stuff like that anymore.
Nope.
And there's just some fun stuff. This.
Oh yeah.
You can see that. That's a David Mendoza impalement.
Dude.
And David Mendoza built the prettiest impalements. He made the one for David Copperfield that had that mirror ball on the top. and it was a gorgeous piece. And this one he had built for Marshall Silver, and Marshall used it on his, Marshall Silver is a motivational speaker, and used it in his hypnosis show and on his, he had an infomercial in the early 90s called Passion, Power, and Profit, and used it there. So now, these are all from the Luxor.
Oh, yes.
my girlfriend Sherry bought these at an auction, and we got those kind of spread out around the house. I also collect collapsible top hats, if you can see that. And I was bored on a ship, and I was out there for so long, and I was like, I'm going to see if there's any top hats, collapsible top hats at a good price. And again, it's eBay. And if they were under, you know, $100, I would buy them. And so now I have like 50 or 60 of them scattered around. This is kind of, I have this curved wall in my house. Let me turn on the light here. And I didn't know what to do with that curved wall. And Bill Smith was moving out of a shop, and he had some of these Carter 8 sheets. And then my girlfriend goes, that would look amazing on that curved wall. So,
God, it's just everywhere, man. It's so, I remember walking in your place, and just, it's like you're walking into a freaking magic museum. It's but it's done well. It's not like crap everywhere. It's done well.
Yeah, I don't want to be one of those guys that looks like, you know, I have to be on hoarders with crap everywhere. But that's a Doug Henning Merlin. That's a 3-sheet. And then I just put this one up yesterday. I just got this one. That's a Doug Henning. The glare is kind of bad, but that's a 2-sheet.
Nice.
And then this is from his first TV special. That's a water torture cell.
I love the artwork.
And then these are really cool. My girlfriend makes these. These are from Tannen catalogs.
That is rad. Especially that it's out of a Tannen's catalog even. That's even cooler, man. That's awesome.
So if anyone wants one of those, contact me and she sells those. But let's, I wonder if I can show you this. This is on top of one of my, can you see that? That's the sword suspension I did.
Yeah. I can totally see the swords. Yeah, right on.
And that's from the LeGrand David show.
Cool.
Okay. And this is, there's some more Carter posters. That's an 8-sheet there. It's got glare from the, and there's the 8-sheet. But this is one of my favorite pieces in the house. This is the Doug Henning statue of the pharaohs. And he would vanish from this chair right here. This is a Dakota chair. He used it on his first TV special in 1975. And then for later on, I think it was, Maybe his seventh special, the Magical Broadway, maybe the 8th special, I'm not sure. He combined the two, so they put that Egyptian motif on it and used it with this prop. And Johnny Gaughan built this for him. And if I can show you this.
You guys are looking at history right there. That is Doug Henning's original illusion. That's the real deal, guys.
Yep. And there's only one of those. It was built in 1978, and there's Doug doing it. And this one is not Doug's, but it was built by Johnny Gaughan. After Andre Cole saw Doug do it on one of his specials. I'm not very good at it. Okay. That's the Gazinta boxes. I actually did that on Masters of Illusion last year. And it's just the Gazinta boxes made stage size, and you can produce one or two girls out of that after you show the two boxes, that one fits the outside, one fits in the inside box.
And by the way, the Henning Illusion, did you perform that one, or did you do a version of it on Masters of Illusion? Because I know you did it.
Yep, TV. I did it on Masters of Illusion. I don't know if I can you see that poster there?
A little bit. Yeah, we see the bottom of it there.
Okay, how about?
There it is. Yeah. There you are.
That was a shot right after I appeared in it on the Masters of Illusion TV show.
So you actually performed the original Doug Henning illusion on TV. That's freaking
yeah,
awesome.
Yeah, how cool is that?
God. Wow.
And then I'll be doing the Walking Through the Mirror pretty soon too. And then, okay.
Oh my gosh.
And then this is where I spend a lot of time during quarantine. This is my office. And I got a, did that lock?
Look at those books. I wonder what those books are. They couldn't be magic books, could they? Ah.
All magic books.
Wow.
That's one side of the library. And then
Yes. Here's
the other side.
Yes. Oh, man. Beautiful.
So this is where I spend a lot of time just working on stuff. I just got this recently, believe it or not. Sherry got it for me. There's an autograph. Johnny Carson.
Wow, that's cool. Very nice.
How fun is that? And then I just don't think my... I don't think I have very good internet connection back there for Skype.
That's okay.
I don't know how bad it was looking.
We were good. I think the real question everyone wants to know is how do you manage to find a woman that will tolerate so much magic stuff in your house? That's a good woman.
You know what?
That is a really good woman.
That's a good question. My ex-wife, it was like, okay, nothing comes out of your office. Magic is in your office and that's it. And, then I was single for a while, and my new girlfriend Sherry lives with me, and she's lived here for the last four years. And she's the one that finds some of this stuff for me. She goes, oh, we're gonna, you know, she, like, I was showing you those Egyptian things, but if you look right next to the Egyptian, there's a bunch of dice stacked up, and she found that at an auction, and I go, that's just like Fred Capps used to do, stacking dice. I have a picture of Fred Capps doing it. So she bought me that, and she's actually bought me quite a few things. She's a...
It's cool. So there are women out there, guys. There are women that will allow us to be us as magicians. So they do exist. Yep. Wanted to give a couple quick shout-outs, then I'm going to let you go, Greg. I know I went over here a little bit with you, so I do apologize for going over that. Got some friends out there from South Africa watching. That's very cool. My friend Sean Zahr is out there. He's on the other side of the world, too. Mark Whitebrow's in England. Had some friends watching earlier from Australia. So it's really cool to have an international group all come together and hang out. And, and thank you as well for spending some time with me, answering these questions, and also showing us around the collection of stuff that you've got there. And I was very excited to see the library. I didn't know if we were going to get to see that. That was a nice little treat. So thank you for that too. That was cool.
My pleasure, Luke. And you're welcome anytime. Come on over.
Thank you, my friend. So from me and Greg Gleason, we're going to say goodbye to you guys. We also have Louise watching out there from Peru. Don't want to forget about our friend in Peru. Good to see you out there, Louise. Thank you for hanging out. And so from me and Greg Gleason, once again, thank you to you guys for hanging out, the feedback, the great questions, and we will catch you both next time. So, see you guys. Take care.
See you guys. Thanks, Luke.